So, sir, can we talk a little bit about what motivated you to get into public service at the local level first, and then why you wanted to run for countywide office?
Absolutely. I've always been interested in politics and public affairs, and I've always felt that for those who have the time, who have the ability, it's important to be involved in your community, whether that's in your church or synagogue, whether it's with your children's activities. Being involved is important for me. I've had a natural desire to be involved in politics, government, public affairs. When we moved to Somerset County, I was living in Greenbrook with, at that time, just my wife. Had an opportunity to serve on the Greenbrook Township Committee, gladly jumped at that, was appointed and then ultimately elected to a term, served approximately 3 years there. We moved to Bridgewater as our family grew. I remained involved. I was on our land use board, our specifically our zoning board, became involved more and more over the years, had an opportunity to run in 2019 for council, and was successful in that race. So for me, it's been a regular part of my life for 30 years. I enjoy it. I enjoy meeting people. I enjoy being hopefully part of the solution.
What do you want voters to think about in terms of your service to date when they go to the polls in advance of November 2nd?
Sure. I think my service to date, most relevant part of it is what's most recent, which is in Bridgewater. We have a great news story to tell in Bridgewater. We keep our budget in line. We invest where we need to, which is most recently in a roads program. And what's most important about service in Bridgewater as part of the team effort is our common sense approach, our common sense solutions. And that's not the case in all levels of government. Looking back to Greenbrook, though, Greenbrook, a much smaller town, different form of government. So for me, knowing two sides of a coin of what it would take to serve at the county level, I think is particularly valuable, both one of the smaller towns, Greenbrook, and one of the larger towns, Bridgewater.
Could you please tell me a little bit about what you'd like to do as a commissioner?
Absolutely. I'm running on a ticket with Amber Murad, and we are committed to restoring confidence and common sense to county government. In the last couple of years, we've lost our way a little bit. Seems like the current crew, very interested in social media, very interested in press releases, very interested in taxpayer-subsidized PR. But it requires rolling up your sleeves and doing the work. It's not just about looking good or trying to look good. It's making good decisions. It's making good decisions that impact people's lives.
When you say that they've lost their way, do you see them making some missteps in terms of taxing and spending specifically?
Yeah, in the area of tax and spend, one substantial misstep, which you will not hear about from the taxpayer-funded PR effort, is that everybody's recycling fee, which is a pass-through from the county to the municipalities, that line item this year is up 10%. So when your local government, when our local government here in Bridgewater opened its doors on January 1st for the year 2021, we were faced with a 10% increase. And then we were left to figure out, how do we accommodate other programs? So the commentary, we kept a flat budget, or we kept a flat tax increase, that's not totally true when you really dig in. It was essentially kicking the can down to the 21 municipalities in that case.
You're running in a particularly challenging atmosphere. We've been through a pandemic, which still clings to the environment. We've suffered casualties. Moreover, we just came through Tropical Storm Ida. How have you seen the county respond to these crises, and what would you want to do differently?
Well, the tragedies are something that I'll remember for the rest of my life during the time I've been involved. In Bridgewater, we've lost over 100 residents to COVID. During the most recent storm, there were 3 fatalities here in Bridgewater. A fourth resident was swept away down toward Flemington. Casts a shadow over everything, candidly, anyone who's in public service. One of the things that, I've been really disappointed with the county is the COVID response. I think that there is an attempt by both the governor and this commissioner board to let people feel good about the fact that now they've gotten their shots And now it seems as though the greatest amount of the crisis is hopefully behind us. They're counting on the fact that we won't remember what it was like in February and March and April. People on the phone at all hours of the day and night, people on the internet at all hours of the day and night trying to find a shot. We were very slow in Somerset County, up and running with a COVID testing. We were among the last. We never had a mega site. I know of people who drove to all parts of New Jersey to get their shot, and they were considered the lucky ones. They felt like the lucky ones. I thought that the response was poor. Giving a specific example in Bridgewater that I'm most familiar with, I'm a liaison to the Board of Education. My colleague, who is liaison back to our township council, he asked me for help. He said, we have school board members, members of our union who want shots. We can't get it. I asked, well, what have you done? Well, we've gone to the county, we've gone here, we've gone there. So I raised that up to our mayor, Matthew Mensch, our administrator, Mike Pappas, and simultaneously they were working with Atlantic Health, a group that we have a relationship with based on a land use application. And Atlantic Health opened a private pod for 400 individuals who were able to get shots. So at a time where they were being stonewalled, within Bridgewater we took care of our own. You talk about the storm, obviously something that none of us will ever forget. One of the things I'm most proud of in Bridgewater is within 40 hours of when the rain stopped, we had an emergency council meeting. We passed appropriations so that we could take care of our damage, and just as importantly, take the debris away from our various neighborhoods. That was going to allow people to move on with their lives. You contrast that with what happened with the county, what happened in Manville, which was particularly hard hit. Manville, counting on the county and the county contract for debris removal, ultimately it was slow, it was confused, it was chaotic, it was with an out-of-state contractor. The folks in Manville were left to wonder, what do I package up? Do I use black bags? Do I use clear bags? What do I do? And ultimately, it took a stressful situation and made it worse. That's on the cleanup. Now, we also really need to talk about what happened with the storm preparation and the lack of preparation with the floodgates in Bound Brook. The Army Corps of Engineers spent $300 million of our taxpayer dollars designing a system to keep Bound Brook dry. Unfortunately, that didn't happen the night of the storm because our county commissioners, there is no record of anybody from county government reaching out to New Jersey Transit in order to begin the process of closing the floodgate. The SOP, Standard Operating Procedure, requires 2 hours advance notice so that New Jersey Transit can have an orderly closing of the Raritan Valley Line. That never happened. The gate was never closed. A train got stuck, and then the gate could not be closed, resulting in flooding in a portion of Bound Brook that should have been protected. One of the things that I'm concerned about, beyond the impact of the people who live there, what is the financial consequence to the taxpayers of Somerset County? What's going to happen the remainder of this year and in 2022 when inevitably the lawsuits happen? What type of liability has lack of action and lack of preparation created for the taxpayers of Somerset County?
We wanted to touch too a little bit on state politics and what you said dovetails with that, and that is the response by those in county government not being fast enough. But would you say that the response by this administration at the state level lagged?
I think that what lagged principally was getting us reopened. In hindsight, closing us down for the first 6 weeks in March and April of 2020 made a lot of sense. We had a disease that we didn't know a lot about. It was a dangerous time. People were dying. There was no testing. So I think that for March and April, a pause made a tremendous amount of sense. But I'm still not clear why in May and June we couldn't get our haircuts, why our kids couldn't return to outdoor playing fields, why there couldn't have been more of an emphasis on getting kids into school for September of last year. Many districts, it took them the whole year, and some of them didn't even make it. There needed to be more of an emphasis on getting back to a level of normalcy in a safe way, and it just didn't happen fast enough.
What about in terms of the response to Ida? It seemed to come very late in the game. We got notified on our phones in the 5 o'clock hour as the storm seemed to be in full swing. And that goes to your criticism of their response in Boundbrook. What do you make of that?
Our phones knew more than apparently our government did. Apparently more than the governor of Pennsylvania did, our neighboring state. Apparently more than every meteorologist that tracked that storm for days, almost a week, on the way up from Louisiana. The real shame of it is that smart decisions were not made. Precautions were not taken. Somerville lost its entire DPW fleet because the machinery, the trucks and other machinery was not moved. The shame of it was there was almost no planning ahead of time. But then, a couple days after the storm, all kinds of planning for the governor to come in, for the president to come in, and to use the people of Manville as a prop, which, in hindsight, was offensive. You have people who lost everything. They needed cleaning supplies. They needed debris removed. They did not need the president of the United States. They did not need the governor of New Jersey. They did not need their commissioners walking around as though they were like the governor or the president. They didn't need, as one of our opponents did, hugs door to door. They didn't need to be put on video. What they needed was mops, they needed cleaning supplies, they needed some help, and they needed some hope. One of the things I'm most proud of is we held a vigil the Sunday night after the storm, because as noted, we lost some people in Bridgewater 4, Bridgewater, Raritan, and some of the surrounding towns. We lost 4 people. The positive that came from that was filling a tent's worth of cleaning supplies. The people of Bridgewater were unbelievably generous. We assessed what we had, realized we had more than we needed to help our own here in Bridgewater, and I gladly helped to load and then ultimately deliver a truck full of supplies over to the Manville VFW hall. So, what did those folks need? They needed cleaning supplies, mops, wipes, bleach. That's what we delivered to them. I'm proud we did it. I do it again. The other thing that residents in Manville need and the businesses in Manville need, they need a return to normalcy of their business sector. So what I've said several times, and I'll say it here, if anyone has some extra time and some extra money, go into downtown Manville. Find a shop, find a restaurant, find a diner. You would be performing a blessing by helping those businesses continue to operate. And you'll also get some great deals and some great food.
You have the experience, you have ideas, and you're well informed and you have a passion. Demographics have changed in our county. And we saw the state senator for our district retire this year. And Democrats have come into power incrementally over the last couple of years. How do you win in this environment? How does a Republican, what are you sensing? What are you seeing out there in terms of the viability of your campaign in this political environment?
It's a great question. I think the first thing that needs to be stated is there's a lot of buyer's remorse out there. As I talk to people, I ask them about their county government, how they feel. I ask them, do they know that it's a 5-0 Democrat commissioner board? Most people don't know that, but people think about it and say, yeah, I kind of get that, because there's been a lot of voter anger the last handful of years. Candidly, I think that Somerset remains a center-right county. I think the key is getting our message out of fiscal responsibility, common sense, and return of a confidence in your government. That's one major piece. The other piece is Amber Murad and I have been partnering with each and every one of our local tickets, because ultimately county government is a reflection of local government. We are standing hip to hip with the ladies and gentlemen that are running for mayor, running for council, running for committee, depending upon their form of government. We have a unified front, we have considerable unified messaging, and that will be our key to success.
Last question, because you're running on the ticket with them. Your sense of Jack Chiatarelli is a gubernatorial candidate, and he also has a county toehold here, of course, as a native Raritan resident and a resident now of Hillsborough, what's your sense of how that may impact your race?
Jack is going to do phenomenally well in Somerset County. I think he's going to do very well across New Jersey as well, but focusing in on Somerset, we talk about Raritan, neighboring community here. People know Jack, people know Jack's family, they know Jack's story. In Hillsborough, same way. He will be a big vote-getter in Somerset County. And I think among the biggest reasons is his message. His message about a return to common sense, a return to a government you can be proud of. And while there are issues and examples at the state level, same way there are issues and examples at the county level and across the 21 municipalities.
Thank you very much for your time, sir.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Best of luck. You bet.